impervious, the lawn, the meadow, the woods, to a specific drainage area, and then summed those up and then averaged the actual cover types going towards the drainage areas. So it's not a weighted average as specified in the Tier 55, it's the actual land types on the site.
Okay, and did the township engineer review those assignments and calculations?
Yes, he has.
And did he have any issues with what you did?
No, he has not.
Okay, please continue going through the letter.
Sure. Disconnection of the, page four, the disconnection of the stream channel from associated floodplains and wetlands. And again, this is also in relationship to basins not discharging throughout the site and channelizing more towards the streams. We have 9 stormwater basins that will discharge in several areas to keep the wetlands wet and the streams wet without degrading them, without increasing the required volume and rate as per the township at the DEP regulations. The basins are not located in the wetlands, but upstream of the wetlands in a typical area of the lower portion of the site where water would drain to. It would be conveyed to the basins, held, routed, and then discharged in a flow that would mimic the required flows from the township or DEP with reductions to the pre-development flows.
Okay, and what water quality measures would you typically have to include in those basins that discharge the wetlands?
Water quality measures would include, per the DEP regulations and the conservation district, as this is, they're going to an impaired streams. We would have to show that we would reduce the total nitrates to 50% of the pre, the total suspended solids and total pollutants to ultimately obtain our NPDES permit for the site. So that is one aspect we would have to do, as well as there's aspects of the water quality in the township code, which makes you treat a percentage of your first flush, your 1 year rainfall event, and treat in some way, shape, or form. But the basins could also be planted with wetland tolerance plantings or wetland tolerant plantings or some other characteristics of landscape to help ultimately clean the water as well.
Okay, and would those water quality features or details be typically something you would include in the fully engineered stormwater plan?
Yes, they would.
As opposed to your conceptual plan?
Correct.
Okay, and please continue in her letter, NC4.
Alterations. Again, on page four, alterations in stream temperature that will adversely impact in-stream water quality and aquatic health. The site, again, as rudimentary design, can show rooftop disconnection, which will help the water to flow over the lawn in the lots and not be directly discharged into the storm sewer system underneath the roads. So that will help to, one, keep the water at a relatively moderate temperature, two, to help contact with the soils and the lawn to help knock out any pollutants ultimately going from the homes, from the lawns to the basins themselves and ultimately to the streams. Other aspects that could be put on here is landscaping around the basins to help shade the basins, to help bring the ambient water temperature down if it is to a certain amount. Also, the basins have been undercut in some instances to help the first flush to settle out and infiltrate into the groundwater. So that again, the first flush will be infiltrated into the site and not leave the site and go into the streams. And that will also help to ultimately bridge the gap if there is an increase in ambient water temperature. But all these techniques have been used throughout several sites within Pennsylvania and have been shown to not adversely impact the water quality of the stream.
Please continue.
The testing locations and test pits are not located on any plan that shows proposed basins. She's correct that there is no overlying plan that shows the basin locations and the test pit locations in this plan set, but the test pit locations are shown on the existing features plans, and you can, places shown on the topo plan reference where the test pits have been located. We've not shown them on the on the design plans just to help clean up the plans. It's less information that needs to be shown on there, but it is shown somewhere else within the site, within the site plan package.
Did the township engineer have any issue with how the information was presented on the plans, to your knowledge?
No, he did not.
Okay, please continue.
And again, the middle of page five, the last bullet point, the plans are lacking basic information to comprehensively review the proposed development for compliance with Westtown Township and PA DEP requirements. As was previously stated, it's my stance that we meet the requirements as well as the township engineer's review letters and correspondence with him and meetings with him, that the overall design is fine. As I've stated previously, and the township engineer has stated in his letter, details will be done during the preliminary plan. And once additional design requirements are met and we get an ultimate layout, and GTA will go out and get additional testing to help aid in the design if the basins are relocated in any way, shape, or form. Comment number on page five, the bottom, number one. As a synopsis, the proposed project will not provide adequate stormwater volume management through infiltration as proposed, and the proposed report on preliminary geotechnical exploration is inadequate.
Do you agree with her conclusion?
Again, as I previously stated, we do have testing in multiple locations throughout the site, which does show that we have infiltration, and if we need to get additional testing during preliminary stages, can do so. But
let me ask you this. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Sure.
Why do you believe the testing that was performed is reasonable to reach your conclusions that there's adequate infiltration?
The conditional use plan has to show that the overall concept can be adhered to, and I believe, and ultimately, the township engineer has also shown no kickback that the plan does not show that.
By kickback, you mean disagreement?
Disagreeing, sorry. The testing, again, throughout the site does show that we do have infiltration in several instances on the site, and all the areas are located with above the seasonal high groundwater upstream of the wetlands and downstream of the proposed home. So it's the typical location for the basins themselves.
And what about rate control? Do you agree with her conclusion with respect to the ability to adequately maintain the stormwater rate, discharge rate?
We believe that the site design shows that we can meet the rate control for the township and the DEP requirements for the reductions to both the east, which is the Radley Run, the west, which is the Radley Run watershed, and to the east, which is the Chester Creek watershed, and associated with the Chester Creek watershed, and the associated reductions.
And what is the basis for your conclusion?
The TR-55 CN numbers, as was previously spoken, they are then run through programs to get the rate and the volume that is generated on the site. That information is then put into a stormwater program, which helps to size the basins. And that, along with some Excel spreadsheets to see the reductions needed, show that we do, in fact, meet the reduction factors of the site.
Okay, please continue on with your letter and C4.
page six, the middle of page six, which is number three, the proposed project has not demonstrated that it will provide adequate volume control as proposed. Again, as previously stated, we believe that calculations do show that this requirement has been met, and also the township and the DEP, when we have preliminary plans, again, will need to review these and issue their results and ultimately obtain a permit or approval to proceed with the site. Number six at the bottom of page six, the creation of steep slopes and the discharge of stormwater onto steep slopes will cause erosion and sediment discharge. The site itself will need to get an NPDES and an erosion permit from the Conservation District and the DEP. The slopes will have to be stable. There will be inspectors from the town and the Conservation District, which will show and they will need to inspect that these slopes have been stable and are not erosive in any way, shape, or form. And if they become erosive for some reason, that the applicant or the developer at that time would have to remediate them with slope stabilization matting or some kind of other technique to stabilize those from eroding any further.
Okay. What else is in her letter?
We've previously talked about the weighted averaging, which is on the top of page seven. The middle of page seven, or top upper area of page seven, which has section 144-306.j, which is about infiltration BMPs, shall be selected based on suitability of soils and site conditions, and shall be constructed on soils that have the following characteristics, and it lists one and two, one of them being 24 inches between the bottom of the BMP and the limiting zone, and the number two is a sufficient rate to accept additional stormwater volume and drain completely. The basins have been designed with a minimum of a half of an inch of infiltration, and I believe a maximum of 2 inches of infiltration. One of the test pits had showed a percolation rate of 4 inches an hour. We used a 50% reduction in that to 2 inches an hour, and that's what we designed the plan for.
So is that a conservative estimate?
That's a conservative estimate, as well as if those BMPs that we have selected at this time need to be altered. As Ms. Adams said, there's other alternatives in the PA BMP manual, such as soil amendments, spray irrigation, planting of landscaping and slopes, and there's a litany of BMPs that could be used for the site. But when we did the original design, the nine basins with the infiltration rate required met that requirement, and that's where we stopped.
Okay. Are you up to the part of the BMP loading ratios yet in her letter?
Right here.
Good time. Could you please highlight that and tell us whether you agree or disagree with her characterizations with respect to the required loading ratios?
On the middle of page eight, it does talk about the loading ratios. Loading ratios is a guidance letter from the DEP and the BMP manual. There has been talks, and there's a letter that has been published from Dominic Rocco of the Southeast portion of DEP that states that the loading ratio is a guidance and higher loading ratios can be achieved on the site. We do not have to adhere to those specific loading ratios.
And in your prior projects, have you been held to the BMP guidance loading ratios, or have you been able to use higher loading ratios?
In our previous projects, we have been able to use higher loading ratios.
Okay. Do you agree with Ms. Adams' assessment as to what the proposed loading ratios are for the basins?
I have not gone through calculations, but on the first glance, it does appear that the numbers appear to be right. Most of the numbers are anywhere from 7 to 12, with a couple ones higher than the 7 to 12. But the letter from Dominic Rocco is an avenue to go higher than that, as well as this is a preliminary design. if and when additional air needs to be done or PMPs made with additional testing, that will all be flushed out during the preliminary plans.
Okay, please continue. Is there anything else in the letter?
I believe I stated this previously, but just to go again on the loading ratios, springboard, the basins themselves have been designed to infiltrate in less than the 3 days requirement for the DEP. And then also some of the basins have been undercut to help store the water and help it infiltrate. We previously talked about the cover assumptions. And just one last point to help the overall site. I don't have a specific one, but I'm sure it would apply. Is the site with the tier 55 that we've done has assumed our house that is shown, the roads that are shown, and has anywhere from 500 to 700 additional square foot of impervious for future residents or future build out. So the basins have been designed as a worst case scenario for the development that has been thought out of this on this project and has been adhered to and shown in the numbers. So the numbers with the pre versus post are the worst case scenario for this development.
And by the additional 500 to 700 square feet, are you referring to potential courtyards or patios?
Correct.
Is there anything else that you're referring to when you say you've basically, is it correct to say you've over-designed?
Courtyards, patios, and yes, we have over-designed the site, so if and when the homeowner comes in with a 50 by 10 patio, or if we can fit a pool on there, that the stormwater has been designed accordingly for that. So that will not affect the downstream homeowners any, and that will be enveloped in the basins themselves.
Okay, any other comments with respect to her letter?
No, that's the general.
Okay. Let me ask you this question. Based upon what you heard from Ms. Adams' testimony and your review of her letter, does any of that information change your earlier opinion with respect to the preliminary or conceptual, strike that preliminary, just conceptual stormwater plan?
No, it does not.
And what was your opinion with respect to the feasibility of the stormwater plan?
The design that has been presented shows the feasibility of the overall stormwater management of the site with the information that we have from GTA, as well as the review from the township engineer.
I have nothing further for Mr. Madden.
Thank you, Mr. Heelman. Cross-exam, anything from Ms. Camp from the Planning Commission?
The township engineer hasn't determined that the stormwater design meets the township stormwater ordinance, has he?
The comment from the township engineer, I can't specifically locate it right now, but in my previous testimony, Exhibit A10, comment number 10, shows that that it demonstrates the ability to provide stormwater management.
Right, so I'll read comment number 10. It says, the applicant has provided a stormwater management narrative for the proposed project, and he has in parentheses, feasibility report. Although the stormwater system proposed demonstrates the ability to provide stormwater management, we caution that the system may warrant reconsideration during land development process to incorporate more multi-structured system of stormwater management by adopting more non-structural and structural design concepts as outlined in PA Best Management Practices Manual. So nowhere in that sentence does the engineer indicate that you have demonstrated compliance with the township stormwater ordinance, correct?
Correct, demonstrates the ability to provide stormwater management.
Okay, and nowhere has the township engineer advised you or anybody that the proposed feasibility or conceptual plans that you have provided to date for stormwater management meet the DEP requirements in order to obtain an NPDES permit, is that correct?
That's correct. We do have to, we know and have stated that we do need to design the site to meet the requirements of the DEP when we get into the preliminary design.
Right, and the township engineer actually in paragraph 12 of the engineer review letter marked A10 identifies your planning as conceptual, correct?
Correct.
Okay, and you tonight testified that your planning is rudimentary. You indicated a rudimentary design in your testimony tonight.
Rudimentary, conceptual, yes.
Okay. If as you do further testing at the next stage, if you get to the next stage of plan development and you do further testing and you determine that some of the basins that you've proposed do not infiltrate to the extent that you need, that they need to, you would have to find additional locations for infiltration on the site, correct?
Either additional areas or additional techniques to infiltrate that water, yes.
And could that affect the layout of the development plan that's been presented as Exhibit A6?
No, I don't believe so. We have shown that the water is able to infiltrate into the basins, and that's where we have stopped. We've met the requirements for the conceptual plan. But there is other avenues, as Ms. Adams stated, that you can do on-lot soil amendments, which can be done on the actual lots themselves, so that would not impact the site layout in any way, shape, or form.
And you agree that Toll will have to perform a much more thorough analysis with more detailed calculations at the land development stage in order to demonstrate compliance with the stormwater ordinance. Is that correct?
We will have to do additional calculations to show that the design, when it proceeds to the preliminary plan stage, meets the township and DEP requirements, correct.
Thank you.
Mr. Crawford, any questions?
No.